The port of Harwich lies on the North Sea coast of Essex and once offered the only safe anchorage between the Thames and the Humber. The port's strategic position made it an ideal target for invasion by Napoleon, so the British built an enormous fort to keep him out. Dan Beck and Colin Farnell helped to run the fort's museum.
The redoubt fort was built between 1808 and 1810. It took 2 years to build. The fort was built on top of the only hill in Harwich, and it was actually on top of the old London Road. This dominated the harbour, basically.
The redoubt, meaning a place of retreat, was designed for siege warfare. Sunken into the ground, surrounded by a dry moat, and with walls 8 feet thick, it was almost invulnerable to attack, and armed with 10 24-pounder cannons to deal with anyone foolish enough to try. The museum is now in the process of clearing out their old stores, offering a plethora of items for Drew to wade through.
Morning. Morning.
How you doing?
Hi.
Drew.
I'm Dan Beck from
Dan.
Yep.
How you doing?
Hi.
What a beautiful day.
It's lovely, yeah. Isn't it?
Let's get on and have a look. A lot to see.
Yep.
Wow, this is pretty impressive, isn't it?
It is impressive, yeah.
Incredible
condition.
So over
here is the parade square, as it was.
And what's that in the middle?
That is a well. So it's a home for 300 soldiers. They could stay here under siege conditions. They've got their own fresh water.
The conditions, what amazing me. It's incredible.
Well, in 1969, this was all virtually derelict. There were no windows, no doors. Rubbish was in there. There was cars in the moat. Most of that was filled up with just rubbish.
You're going to have to tell me about that enormous gun over
Certainly.
There.
Certainly. Come this way.
That is huge.
It weighs 12 tonnes.
Blimey.
And there were three of them originally here.
Right.
And it was discovered as we were clearing out the moat and eventually, with the help of the army,
yeah.
we managed to bring it up here. It was far about 2 miles, so it was far right across the harbour there. Any French ship that even ventured up the harbour would be well within the range. So I think if that was fired today, it'd probably break every window in Harwich.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
The fort is amazing. I've never seen anything like this before. I don't know what I'm going to find today, to be honest with you. We're in a fort in Essex. Anything could happen.
What did the soldiers do in here?
Well, this is an artillery and general store. So they would have had ammunition and gunpowder.
Right.
And this room we're going into now is where the gunpowder was stored. You can still just smell the acrid smell.
Yes.
Yeah, it's just there.
Yes.
And we know it was gunpowder, because if you look at this window here, you obviously wouldn't have a candle to come in here, so you put the candle behind the glass.
Yeah.
And you could see what you were doing in here.
Safety first.
Yeah.
Even with that behind there, I'd be nervous.
I'd be very nervous as well. Yeah.
Amazing.
As well as the rooms turned into a museum, some of the chambers contain items no longer in use.
Ah, stackerbys. And they have a following. People do buy them, but I have to say they are without doubt one of the most uncomfortable chairs you can possibly sit on. That's just horrible. Sit,
yeah.
Have a sit.
Yeah.
Try it out.
Yeah, so it makes you sort of tip back a bit.
Yeah, yeah, it's not nice.
The stackerby chair was designed in the 1950s by Australian Harry Sebble. Of tubular steel construction, as the name suggests, they're stackable. And this innovative system made them a popular design. In restored condition, they could have a value of around £70 each.
Shame they've been painted.
I think there's about 70 here, so in total.
What do you want for them?
Sort of £20 a chair or?
1,400 quid, no, can't do it.
And what price would you?
Well, if they weren't painted, £20-25 each easily, you know, easily all day long we'd be paying you that for them.
Yeah,
it's the paint, the overpaint. Each chair needs completely stripping and painting, or you just sell them as they are. It's a great find because there's so many, you could do a couple of restaurants with these.
Hmm.
If they were just one colour,
yeah.
I'd be biting your hands off.
Go and get a paintbrush quick.
I'm in two minds about the chairs. Maybe a decade ago, I'd have bought them, no matter what. But now, things have moved on. My customer base has changed, styles have changed, and the amount of time we have to spend on items has changed as well. And they need a lot of work. Loads of work. So, not for me today.
It's a strict business decision on the chairs. But despite his disappointment, Drew's hoping some of the other 18 chambers may be hiding some salvage gems.
OK, so what have we got in here?
Should be a light fitting at the back here.
But that's of interest to me. The floor stand, if it's got its wheels.
Yeah, I think it has.
It has. OK. They're just a brilliant design, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
So clever. So clever. One thing I can't miss as soon as I walk in is a floor-standing angle-poised lamp in my favourite colour, black. It's a good one. It's complete bar the shade. But it's all there, and we can restore it. They're handy. They're great mood lighting. They just look good when they're off as well. So this is definitely something I want to buy.
The angle-poised lamp was invented in the 1930s by automotive engineer George Carwardine. A specialist in vehicle suspension, he created a new type of spring that could be both flexible and stable, and used it in the design of a lamp for his factory. In restored condition with a new shade, this floor-standing angle poise could have a value of around £600.
In this condition, with the top on it, I pay sort of 150 to 180 for it. As it is, 100 quid. In this condition, With the top on it, I pay sort of 150 to 180 for it. As it is, 100 quid without that shade.
Yeah. OK.
Sure?
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Super. Thank you.
Cool. Well, yeah, I'll have that, but it's got a nice original paint on it. Just seen that, actually, behind there as well. That cabinet there, T, can you just spin that round?
From one of our displays, actually.
Medical cabinet.
Yeah.
Poisons.
Would you want to get rid of that?
I'm not too sure. It's was part of our sort of first aid medical display.
Prior to the 1900s, medicines were often kept in a chest in the bedroom or pantry. With the introduction of indoor toilets, people began keeping medications and cosmetics in a cabinet in the bathroom. In restored condition, this 20th century steel and glass unit could be worth in the region of £300.
This one's been turned into a poison cabinet, but what remains underneath it is a very good quality steel cabinet with its original London brass plaque on the top. Most of the glass is still there, but it does need two shelves. We can buy those. The glass to the front, and then we're going to have to strip all the paint off. Does the lock work, T? Twist it.
No.
What could you give for that? £75. Would have been like 150 if it was complete, at least, even if it needed restoring.
Quite happy.
Are you?
Yeah. All right.
Thank you. With two restoration projects already acquired, the boys see what else they can find.
What's this then?
This is the electrical switch room. And we've got some old redundant fittings here. So
light fittings. Yeah. Big Max looms by the looks of them, or are they Benjamins? How many of these have you got?
There's two of those.
Yeah.
Another grey one there with the cap on.
Yeah, I'll buy as many of these as possible.
Yeah.
They're nice, decent size. As traditional with me, there is some industrial lighting. Tough as old boots. You can beat the hell out of them. You can leave them as they are, clean them up, polish them, whatever you want to do. They look good in any environment. They can go into pubs and clubs. They look good, just one over a low kitchen table or worktop. Whatever you do with them, they look good. Again, clean, timeless, simple design.
These mid-20th century enameled pendant lights were once prevalent in factories and industrial settings throughout the UK and were also used by the military. Now a design classic, they could have a value of around £150 each.
So I think it's just going to be those three then. That one, as it is a tenner. It's missing its cap, that is what it is. I'd go £50 for the pair. So £60 the three. I think that's where I'm at. Because they're a bit mismatched.
Yeah, deal? OK, deal. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, cheers, thank Brilliant. You.